This is Penrose Unilluminable room. All the walls are mirrored, so you might think that you could put a source of light anywhere, and just by bouncing around off the walls, the light will eventually reach every single part of the room. The room will be entirely illuminated by a single point of light. But actually, there's something really clever about the shape of this room that means, in fact, it doesn't matter where you put a point source of light, it will never be able to reach every part of the room. There will always be regions in darkness. So what is it that's so clever about the shape of this room?
Hey, Future Steve here in the edit. Just to say, I've spotted that Action Lab just released a video on this very topic. These days, I think if I can add to the discussion, then I'll release the video. I think I can in this case. Like, for example, I think I've got a really intuitive explanation of why Penrose room is unilluminable. Sort of do with the way ellipses work. Anyway, Action Lab's video is great as always. I'll put a link on the end screen so you can watch it after this one. It's also in the description there.
The question was originally posed by Ernst Strauss. He said, will a mirrored room always be fully illuminated by a point source of light? And like a square room obviously will be, because all the points around the square can be reached directly from the point source. But what about a U-shaped room? Well, it's not hard to imagine that with enough bouncing around, you can easily get round that corner and then subsequently illuminate the whole thing. So how was Roger Penrose able to come up with a room that can't be illuminated in this way? Well, first let's see the room in action. Well, if I put the light source here, then everything's illuminated except these two regions. If the light originates from one of these funny side rooms, then this region is illuminated and this region isn't. And if I put the light source in the middle, it's the four little side rooms that remain dark. It's also fun to play around with a bit of fog and some lasers. Nils Berglund very kindly gave me permission to show you his simulation of particles in an unilluminable room. Links to his videos in the card in the description. You can see how the particles never end up escaping below this line. In this simulation, you can follow the colors and you'll see that the blue light never reaches this region, the yellow light never reaches these two regions, and the red light never reaches these four regions. The reason light behaves this way in Penrose room is because of something you probably already knew about ellipses. So look, this part of the room is half an ellipse, and this part of the room is half an ellipse as well. And crucially, this point and this point are the focal point of the ellipse. You might know that an ellipse can be constructed by fixing a piece of string at the two focal points and then using a pen to pull the string taut and then drawing around the whole thing. But the important property of an ellipse for our purposes here is that a ray of light originating from one of the focal points will always be reflected onto the other focal point. It doesn't matter where on the ellipse it's reflected, it'll always end up there. Actually, it's possible to reframe this whole thing in terms of billiards and billiard tables. Is it possible to construct a billiard table with no pockets or anything like that? It's the shape of the table that you can change in such a way that it doesn't matter where you place the billiard ball, there will always be another part of the table that can't be reached by the billiard ball just by it bouncing off the walls. And of course, we're assuming a point-like billiard ball and no friction and all that stuff. In fact, Alex Belos built an actual elliptical billiard table to show that if the billiard ball starts at one focal point, it'll always end up at the other focal point. Link to that video in the card and the description. But what does all this mean for a billiard ball or a ray of light that doesn't start at one of the focal points? Well, let's start at the focal point and we'll draw the tangent line and the normal line at the point where the light is reflected. Now let's move the origin of the light source a little into the middle. As we do that, the angle of incidence is reduced, and we know that the angle of reflection equals the angle of incidence, so the angle of reflection is reduced as well. In other words, if we move the origin of the ray of light into the middle a little, then the reflected ray of light will move into the middle a little as well. I've demonstrated that using a randomly chosen point around the ellipse where the light ray is reflected, but of course, this will be true for all points around the ellipse by definition of an ellipse. That means that any ray of light that passes between the two focal points will always be reflected in such a way that the reflected ray of light also passes between the two focal points. In other words, a ray of light that passes between the two focal points will never end up outside of those two focal points. Here's another animation from Nils Berglad that shows that really nicely. Similarly, if we were to move the origin of the light ray out a little, that increases the angle of incidence, and so the angle of refraction increases as well. And so the reflected ray of light will also be outside the two focal points. So any ray of light that starts outside the two focal points will always remain outside the two focal points. That means that if you put a point source of light anywhere in this region, then all the reflected rays must pass between the two focal points. They will never cross these two lines, and so they will never reach these two regions. The same is true, of course, for the bottom half of the room, which is just a mirror image of the top half. Similarly, if you put the point source of light in one of these two regions, then all the rays will originate outside of the two focal points, and so they will always stay outside of those two focal points. And so this region will remain dark. It's worth noting that this doesn't work 100% for real light. That's because real light travels as a wave, and so you get something called diffraction. Light bends around corners, essentially. In this simulation, you can see it quite nicely. Look, the waves originate in this region, but you can see some of them end up where they shouldn't be. One really nice part of Action Lab's video, by the way, is he builds an unilluminable wave tank, and he shows how ripples in the water get trapped in certain regions. Though if he'd used longer wavelengths, he may have noticed that ripples ended up in parts of the tank where they wouldn't have if it was just point-like particles. But here's a question. What about these mushroom-shaped bits of the room? Do they need to be a specific shape? Is there a formula for that, an equation for that? Everything that I could find online suggested that these curves were ellipses, but like, any ellipse or a specific ellipse? Does it have to be the same ellipse as the big ellipse, only scaled down? It's an important question because I need to get a guide laser cut that I could slide this metal shim into after I'd polished it to a mirror finish. So I decided to go to the original source material, the paper written by Roger Penrose on the subject, except he never wrote a paper. There isn't a paper. It turns out the source material is actually a quiz written by Roger Penrose for the Christmas edition of New Scientist magazine in 1958. So I had to get hold of this magazine. I found a collector online and we made a deal. And here it is, the Christmas edition of New Scientist 1958. Isn't that amazing? That's what New Scientist looked like all those years ago. Look. Two pages of puzzles by L.S. Penrose and Roger Penrose. This is where the question was set, question number 7 there. And Roger Penrose's solution is there in the back, figure 4. And in the text it says, the precise shape of the lower curve is unimportant, but it must lie below the major axis and touch it at Q and R. So there you go. Actually, they don't need to be mushroom shaped. They don't need to be ellipses. They can be any shape so long as it's below that line. Nils Berglund very kindly ran a couple of simulations with different shaped mushrooms, which seems to support the idea. I really enjoyed making the unilluminable room because I enjoy making stuff, but not as much as I enjoyed making this thing with my kids. I mean, they did most of it. I was barely involved. It's a sandwich making machine. I'm telling you this, by the way, in relation to the sponsor of this video, KiwiCo. I mean, this isn't a KiwiCo project, so why am I telling you about it? Here's the thing. This is what they do between KiwiCo projects now. The bread goes in one end, a butter goes through this hole, jam through this hole, then it all gets squished down with this handle thing, which is a nightmare, by the way. It just sticks to the handle. I don't know why they put that in there. The second slice of bread goes in here, and then it comes out of the cup. I mean, how good is that? And here's the thing, like, over the years of getting KiwiCo crates, they've developed this maker's mentality. So they'll see a box and they'll get excited. And I think, what can we make with that? I mean, not as excited as they get when actual KiwiCo comes. But it's just amazing to see them thinking like makers, because I was exactly like that growing up. KiwiCo is a subscription service where you get a STEM project in the post once a month. Everything you need for the project is there in the box. There's no running to the shops or anything like that. And there are 9 different subscription lines for every possible age group. We often find it difficult to find activities that are appropriate for a 4-year-old and a 7-year-old simultaneously. We've got a subscription for both of them that are age appropriate. And when we're working on the projects as a family, It's just great. And the discussions that they stimulate, they're always coming out with these questions as they're doing Kiwi Co-Crates, wanting to understand, you know, how sound works, how light works, how electric circuits work. If you use my special URL, you'll get 30% off any crate. Go to kiwico.com/stevemould30. The link is also in the description, so check out Kiwi Co today. I hope you enjoyed this video. If you did, don't forget to hit subscribe, and the algorithm thinks you'll enjoy this video next.